Hello, I'm Lou. Welcome to this Westminster Abbey Q&A discussion with Dr Miranda Kaufmann. That's following on from the lecture that she gave on Africans in Tudor and Stuart Westminster. To formally introduce Dr Kaufmann, I'm going to hand over now to my colleague, Dr Jamie Hawkey, canon theologian here at the Abbey. Thanks, Jamie.
Thank you, Lou, and hello everyone. Good afternoon. It's lovely to welcome you here, at least virtually, to Westminster Abbey. You can see the Abbey's nave behind me, and I regret to say that I'm not sitting in a chair facing outside the west door. I'm sitting in my study with a backdrop. But we very, very much hope that you'll be able to visit us here in person sometime soon. I have the privilege to oversee our wonderful learning department with its wonderful and transformative work. And it's a real delight to welcome this afternoon Dr. Miranda Kaufmann, whose lecture you've all heard. I want to say a particular thank you to her for recording the lecture for us and for being willing to engage in the question and answer this afternoon. Miranda is leading this masterclass, which of course has as much contemporary resonance as it does historic importance. So you're very, very welcome to this discussion. Hope you have a wonderful afternoon, and we look forward to welcoming you to the Abbey in person at some point soon. So I'm going to hand now back to Lou, I think.
Yes, thank you. So to all the students and teachers who are watching, thank you ever so much. You've sent in so many questions. We were flooded with questions. I apologise in advance if your particular question is not put to Dr Kaufmann today, but we have sort of assimilated as many as we can, and we're going to go through as many as we can in the time that we have together. So first question up is from Carius from Esher College. I'm just going to put my glasses on for this one. And Carrie Ed's question, Miranda, is this: out of the 360 Africans living in Renaissance Britain, where does it look like the majority immigrated from?
Right, thank you everybody, and thanks for tuning in today. Okay, so let's just dive straight in there because there are so many questions. Let's try and get through as many as we can. The problem is that the nature of the sources means that we don't actually know exactly where the majority of Africans that we have records of came from, in terms of the fact that sometimes they're just listed with words like ethnic descriptors like Blackamoor or Ethiop, and Ethiop doesn't mean from modern day Ethiopia. It was used much more generally. But if we look more broad, there are a few instances where somebody's it says they're from Guinea. So we know that was sort of the west coast of Africa. Again, some of these geographical terms were quite vague, or from Barbary, or, which was what they called Morocco. But if we look more broadly at the way that Africans were moving around the world at this time, we can see that Africans were coming to Britain with English merchants who were trading with West Africa and Morocco. That was one way that Africans could have come here. Some of them were coming from Europe because there were larger black populations in Spain and Portugal and Italy in this period. And those Africans that got to Europe, usually again from sort of North and West Africa. And then when English people capture Africans in privateering raids on Spanish and Portuguese ships in the Atlantic, again, those Africans were being usually trafficked across the Atlantic. From an area known as Senegambia, so between the Senegal and Gambia rivers. So sort of broadly, I'd say most of them are coming from West Africa, but we can't always be much more specific. Although, you know, in the book we do have you know, the Prince of River Sestos, so we know exactly where he came from. So that's something modern day Liberia.
That's great. Thanks, Miranda. Fantastic. Now, I have to say that we had so many questions from students who were really interested in John Blank's life. Obviously, you've told us quite a bit about John Blank's life in your presentation, but I really felt that there was quite a strong feeling of, but Miranda, what is your personal opinion on how he came to be in Britain and what happened to him next? Everybody wants to know what happened to him when he, you know, at the end of his life, and how much light can you throw on that?
Oh, well, none. there's no evidence. I think when I was writing the book pretty much I've written everything I know in that chapter one, but when I was writing the book, there wasn't, the earliest record I knew of about like locating him at the Tudor court was 1507. And so although people had theorized that he'd come with Catherine of Aragon, of course, Catherine of Aragon arrives in 1501. So there's this gap of 6 years and you're like, I did find this other sort of Europe. I can't even remember who it was now, but there was some other sort of European nobility who had been shipwrecked on the English coast. So I thought that was potentially another potential route. But since then, Michael Ojiro found this 1502 reference to John Blank playing at the funeral of Prince Arthur. And so that ties the dates much more closely together. So I do think that that, even though we don't have a specific sort of passport stamp on his arrival in Plymouth, I think it is pretty likely that he came from Spain in the entourage of Catherine of Aragon. You know, as we were saying, there's a much bigger population, black population in Spain at this time, so that makes sense. And in terms of what happened afterwards, again, you know, he just disappears from the records after 1512, but hopefully people will do more research and maybe find things. You know, as more and more records get digitized, it does become slightly easier to search for people. And the name does appear in sort of some other records from the London area, but there's just nothing to sort of pin it together. But yeah, unfortunately, I'm going to give that annoying historian answer and say there's no evidence. So it's up to you to decide. Yeah, choose your own adventure. Write your story of what you think happened to John Blank after he got married.
That's great. Thanks, Miranda. Yes, I wonder whether one of the historians watching this session today might, you know, give us some more answers in the future. Thank you. Right, now we've got a question from John. John asks, who did you find the most interesting in your research and why?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that you say everyone's really interested in John Blank, and I do feel like that's because we have a picture of his face. I think that does kind of connect us with him. But, you know, as you saw in the lecture, we only have these fragments of his life. I mean, I think, you know, whichever one I was writing about, I found the most interesting at the time. But I do have a soft spot for Diego, because I think his life is just sort of so swashbuckling and such a sort of, you know, amazing story of him sort of joining Drake and connecting him with the Cimmeroons and then sailing around the world. And, you know, again, his sort of four years in Plymouth are, you know, a bit vague. We don't have any detail on that. So again, that could be another history homework. Write the story of Diego's four years in Plymouth and what he might have got up to. Yeah, he might have gone off and fought, you know, in that horrible campaign in Ireland, but with Drake, but that's another story. And I do think, yeah, Dedri Jacawa, Prince of Rizvasestos, is a really interesting story as well. Especially because, you know, as a prince, he's sort of challenging those preconceptions of the roles of Africans in that period in England. And you know, I just really like this moment where this East India Company merchant encounters him at Rizvasestos and is sort of bowled over by the fact that he can speak really good English. And you know, I like that kind of confounding expectations. But they're all great stories, and you know, do dive in and find out about them. Oh, when I say dive in, the salvage diver is a great story too. So. Anyway, carry on. What's next?
Just out of interest, Miranda, did you have a whole load of characters that you had to sort of cut for that book? And if so, what are you going to do with those extra characters that you've researched?
No, unfortunately, the reason that I chose those 10 was really because they're the ones we know the most about, where there's slightly more meat on the bones. There was one that I cut because we couldn't be quite sure whether she was of African or East Asian origin. Maybe I should just put that on my website sometime. But I have sent it on to some other scholars who are looking at that period, so who knows. Actually, somebody is researching the life of Harry Domingo, who was an adulterous highwayman in Aberdeen in the early 17th century. So that's another great character that, you know, I didn't know much about when I was writing the book, but it'd be great if someone wrote, hopefully she'll write that up at some point as well. There's more to be found. There's more to be found in the archives.
Definitely sounds that way. Thank you. Right, lovely. Well, the next question comes from Eugenie from Upton High School. And Eugenie's question is, in Tudor society, did the African community preserve their culture or did they have to anglicise themselves to fit in?
I think again, this is one where we don't have a lot of evidence to really fully answer that question. And I know that's an annoying historian answer again, but I suppose the records that we do have of baptisms, marriages and burials show that they were kind of anglicising themselves, but more importantly, they were Christianising themselves and Protestantising themselves. And it wasn't just Africans that had to do that in order to fit into Tudor society. I mean, if you were not a baptised Christian, you were not going to be treated as an equal in Tudor society. For example, you're not allowed to marry in the Church of England unless you're being baptised. And so you do find Africans being baptised 3 weeks before being married. So I suppose the short answer is that yes, but it wasn't exclusive to Africans, in that we also have records of Jews conforming to the Church of England. Like there are several Portuguese Jewish families that sort of ostensibly kind of live their lives in the parish. You could be fined for not going to church, and you have refugees from Europe as well, and merchants, and it's very cosmopolitan. Tudor society is a lot more cosmopolitan than people sometimes imagine, especially obviously in London, but the second most cosmopolitan place was Norwich at the time. So yes, but I mean, we don't have that interior life. I suppose again, John Blank's turban is quite an interesting point to discuss on that. Was he wearing that turban as a retention of his cultural heritage, or Henry VIII liked playing dress up. So, Henry VIII was dressing up as a Moor or a Turk half the time. So, we can't be certain, but yeah.
Fantastic, thank you. Lovely, right. Now, the next question comes from Jenny from King's Academy. Thank you, Jenny, for this question. And your question was, do you perceive any sense of intersectionality in terms of the experience of Black Tudors? For instance, where does gender come into the mix? Were the experiences of Black men and women different, do you think? And did class come into play? You might need a bit of time for this one, Miranda, and you've got a bit of time.
That's right. So I think intersectionality wasn't that something that I was thinking about very explicitly when I was writing the book, which I feel, I'm not even sure I knew what that word meant when I started, certainly not when I started doing the research in 2004. I did think a lot more about gender when I was creating the Future Learn Black Tudors course, where we had a whole week on, it's available now, we have a whole week on women and gender in week five of that course. And of course there's intersectionality, and African women's opportunities in Tudor society were much more curtailed than those of African men because they were women. English women weren't having the best time of their lives most a lot of the time either. But for example, we find African men working independently as craftsmen, so a silk weaver, needlemaker, or pursuing kind of skilled roles like John Blank the trumpeter or Jacques Francis the salvage diver, or working as sailors like Diego or John Anthony. So they're able to sort of earn a living in those ways and travel the world and have that independence. Whereas the women we encounter are much more much more likely, well, not more likely to be in domestic roles, but they are in domestic roles. And possibly Anne Cobby as an independent woman in Gloucestershire is relatively unusual. I mean, there are women who there are women who inherit small legacies in the wills of their former employers, which gives them a measure of financial independence. And you know, there's also, as we talked about in the lecture, Anne Cobby, you know, is able to make quite a lot of money for herself through prostitution. But I think that you know, that sometimes gets read backwards. So there's more evidence of African prostitutes in the 18th century, and that often gets read backwards. But actually, there isn't a huge amount of evidence of African prostitutes in this period. So I don't want to sort of overemphasize her experience, but I think that tackles the gender side of things. And class, again, I mean, you know, absolutely, you know, as one might expect, you know, in the sort of in the same ways as you know, we have issues, there are intersectional issues in our own society. But I think that, so for example, Prince Deri Jakawa comes with a lot of sort of cultural capital, as do several of the other Africans coming here from directly from Africa with English merchants do tend to be princes or sons of sons of sort of, you know, higher ranking people in their own societies. And, you know, when the Moroccan ambassador and his entourage show up, they're obviously treated as ambassadors. You know, and again, but if you had a skill like John Blanc or Jacques Francis, then you were treated in a certain way. That gave you opportunities. But if you had been captured from a Portuguese ship by a privateer, you didn't have anything. You were coming here with nothing, and that would obviously affect your sort of life chances.
Right.
There's so much more one can say on that, but I think that will do for now.
I think you've definitely covered that. That's fantastic. Thank you. Lovely. Now, we did touch on religion just a couple of questions back, but we did have two questions, one from Lucy and one from Soliana, two questions that are kind of very similar. So Lucy's question, were all Black Tudors in England Christians? And Soliana's question, are there any records of Africans in Tudor England who followed a faith but were not Christian? And I know we sort of touched on this a little bit, but could you just expand that a bit more for us, please?
So again, sort of not a lot of evidence, again, looking, you know, what we know about religious practices in North and West Africa, and we know obviously that there were large Muslim populations there, but also people who would have had more kind of animist faiths, and I suppose we can assume that, you know, people brought that knowledge and those religious ideas with them. Although if they'd arrived as young children, then they maybe might not have had, like for example, Mary Phyllis, but. I mean, it depends, you know, how you define it, but when we have records of baptisms, especially if they're adult baptisms, then we can kind of posit that they had those other faiths kind of in their hinterland. Again, there's this debate about John Blank's turban and whether that reflects any a kind of maybe a Muslim past, but again, he gets married in 1512, so by that point he must be a Christian, and he certainly sort of words his petition for a pay rise in 1509 in Christian terms. But, you know, again, like as we were saying earlier, that was what you had to do to sort of get on. The only other point faith is that there were these several African servants in the households of these Portuguese conversos or Jewish merchants, and so it's plausible that they might have also sort of followed the Jewish faith in private at home, even though ostensibly, you know, conforming to the Church of England.
Fabulous. Thanks, Miranda. That's great. Okay, and a question from Chester School now. What forms of discrimination and racism do you think Africans in Tudor England faced?
That's another big question, isn't it? Again, the evidence that I looked at is not as kind of illuminating as it might be, in that, you know, that and I think that this is again something that I didn't really get to the bottom of in my book, and I think this is an area where historians need to work with literary scholars. You know, there's a long history of people studying Shakespeare, for example, looking at Othello, but there are many other black characters in early modern drama, exploring issues of race and racial ideas forming, you know, in that literature. And I think now it's important for, you know, the next generation of scholars to take the things they've learnt from looking at the literature and put it alongside the more quotidian pieces of evidence of the sort that I've looked at, like parish registers and court records. And I mean, I think that, again, something we thought about making the Future Learn course was, you know, now, you know, we, again, we sort of talked so much. I think my understanding of racism is deepening, hopefully, as the years continue and keep thinking about it and all of the discussion for the last year, particularly very intensely. I'm quite interested in this definition of the difference between structural or institutional racism and interpersonal racism. And so I think that what I've found about the way Africans were treated by the law and by the church in Tudor society, you know, might go towards an argument that perhaps there wasn't any like institutional racism established at this point, partly because there was a very small African population. It was a new thing in a lot of ways. And so there hadn't been time for the institutions to kind of react. I mean, there wasn't even an official conversion ceremony in the sort of Book of Common Prayer, I think, until the 17th century, late in the 17th century. So they kind of cobbled these adult baptisms together from, you know, the infant baptism and when you had to rehearse your creed and things, I think confirmation or something like that. So I think, yeah, looking at this question, it's interesting to make that distinction between institutional racism and interpersonal racism. But, you know, I have looked at things like wages, and there doesn't, you know, John Blank seems to be being paid similar levels of wages to the other trumpeters at court. There are these opportunities. And I think that when you compare the experiences of Africans in Tudor England with what happens later in British colonies and in later centuries in England, you can see that, you know, that things weren't quite as bad, perhaps. Say that.
Right. Well, it's interesting how you ended that answer, because actually we have a whole raft of questions from students who are particularly interested in sort of how we get from the picture that you paint of what the experience of Africans in Tudor England was like, how we get from there to the whole period of, you know, the 18th, 19th centuries and slavery. So a question now then from Hannah from Sheffield Academy asks, she says, you stress in your presentation the equality seen in society through religious and legal acceptance of Africans in England in the 15 and 1600s. But you allude to a change in attitudes and status by the 1800s. When, why, and how did attitudes change? Another big one there. So when, why, and how did attitudes to Africans change?
Well, a lot of work has been done on Africans in Britain in the long 18th century, but not a huge amount has actually been done in the 17th century. So my research sort of finished for my doctorate in around 1640, I sort of took it up to the Civil War period. And a lot of other scholars kind of start maybe in the 1660s, but they kind of quite quickly get sucked into the 18th century because there's more evidence and there's a lot to say about the 18th century. So I think there's actually a PhD student currently in Lancaster who's doing her PhD on Black Stuarts. So she's kind of, I think that 17th century period is really where we need to look really carefully at what was happening in Britain, how to really pinpoint the how, the when, you know, and the how and the why. But I think at the same time, we do have more of an idea of the why, particularly from scholars of the Caribbean. So I'm actually looking at Caribbean history more now, and I've been reading a lot about this. And Barbados is very much sort of seen as the sort of what's the word? Not the melting pot, the crucible of a lot of these sort of institutionally racist measures. So Barbados is one of the earliest sort of colonies. I mean, Virginia is founded in 1607, but the English get to Barbados in 1627. But Barbados becomes a society with a large number of enslaved people faster, and it's where the first sort of slave code is written in 1660, I think. I think that a lot of the answer is to do with the way that enslavement emerges in these early colonies, and I think it comes from initially an economic motive that enslaved labor, you know, proves to be the most efficient way of producing these labor-intensive crops like sugar, and then the experience of living in that society. And that is brought back, and quite early on, Africans then are being brought back to London and England from those colonies by their enslavers, and so that experience of living in a society where Africans are enslaved and demeaned in that way, obviously, you know, changes the way they're perceived. But you know, there's still more work needs to be done as to how that evolves and how it, most importantly, I think a lot of work has been done on how it evolves in the society in those Caribbean islands or in early America, but not so much has been done on how that plays out in England. But I mean, I have recently seen a 1647 will made in England, leaving two enslaved men to the man's brother, but they are living in Barbados. But you know, so that it happens quite quickly, I think, in the, you know, sort of the middle years. If you look at British involvement in trading and trafficking of enslaved Africans, there's really not a lot of activity until the 1640s. And then suddenly, if you look at slavevoyages.org, which is a massive database of all those voyages, it just goes up sort of exponentially. I'm probably not using that term properly, but it goes up a lot from in the 1640s and 50s, and sort of really takes off from that point. So there's a big shift. You know, there's a big shift. So I think that you know, enslavement and colonialism is the why, really, a lot of times. Certainly for the institution. But more research and discussion needs to happen on that.
Great, and you've given us a fantastic tip there of a website, slavevoyages.org, I think you said, Miranda, which sounds like a really good one for students to sort of get their teeth into and have a look at themselves. Thank you for that. So Zara from Harris Westminster wants to know, under which monarch from the previous centuries do you think Africans experienced the most equality and why?
I don't think we can really answer that question, because I don't think that the change of monarch has that much impact on institutions or the way people view each other. It's not that neat. You don't say, all right, the new there's a new king, we're going to treat people differently. So I think we have to think more in shifts over time in a much broader way.
So in that case, then, would you suggest then, from what you've researched already, would you suggest that under the sort of the general Tudor period, then, that Africans experienced more equality than any other, would you think, in the past? Or,
well, I'm increasingly hesitant to sort of try and argue that Africans ever experienced equality. I'm not sure that's the right term to be thinking in, because, you know, because partly of all the things we've already been talking about with intersectional prejudice and things. And although you know, racism as we know it today didn't really, you know, exist in those terms, in that, you know, ideas about race have evolved over time in a lot of different ways. But clearly there was prejudice and there was intersectionality as well, in that, you know, in the book I talk a lot about, you know, class and religion being more, you know, the main sort of ways in which people were judging each other. But obviously, if somebody were to encounter someone with darker skin in the street, questions might be raised in their mind about whether they were a Christian or not, or where they came from and how much class they had. I mean, that would obviously depend on what clothes they were wearing. There's lots of other factors that people take in when they make snap judgments about each other. But yeah, I'm not sure it's the right. I'm not sure quality is the right lens to be kind of approaching the question through, really.
Great. Now, a lot of the questions that we've had so far, Miranda, have obviously focused very much on the topic that you did your lecture on, which was, you know, fascinating. But we also had loads of questions from students about your work as a historian, you know, your methods of research and that kind of thing. So I think we'll do some questions now on that sort of whole area. So we'll start off with Hallie, who wants to know what sparked your interest in this topic.
My mind wandered in a lecture. I was in this lecture in my last year of university, and it was about early modern trades, and it was pretty boring. And then suddenly my ears pricked up because the lecturer said that the English had started trading to Africa in the 1550s. And I just had never heard about that. And, you know, I'd been obsessed with the Tudors since I was about nine, and I had never ever heard about that. The only time we'd been taught about trade with Africa was in the context of the slaving in the 18th century. So I went to the library to try and find out more, and then I quite quickly found references to Africans actually in England, but there wasn't a lot of material about it. So that's when I decided I had to find out more.
That's brilliant. Thanks, Miranda. Great. Freya asks the question, what specific sources, either written during the Tudor period or modern, did you find the most useful for finding information on Africans in the Tudor period?
Well, I do like to go back to the primary sources. Like I said, when I went to the library in 2004, there wasn't a lot of secondary material. Since then, there are a couple of key books the original key book was Peter Fryer's Staying Power, which is sort of before David Olusoga, the first kind of really big overview of Black history in Britain, going back to sort of before the Romans and coming through to his present day of the 1980s. And there were a couple of pages in that book on the Tudor period, which had really useful footnotes. So that was really helpful. And since I started my research, you know, several other scholars have written about this, specifically Imtiaz Habib, but Black Lives in the English Archives that came out in about 2008. And Onyeka Nubia has written two books now about Africans in Tudor society. And so those are obviously really important now if you want to look at books. But in terms of, and they're both, you know, very rich and detailed. In terms of primary sources, if you want to, in order to get a sense of the population and how widely spread the African presence was across Britain, then parish registers are the most useful, but they are very brief, and you can supplement them a bit with tax returns, but there doesn't seem to be as much material about Africans and tax returns. But in terms of the most interesting, it's got to be court records, legal records, because that's when you get more of a story. You get detailed sort of depositions, sometimes from the Africans themselves, talking about whatever it is that the court case is about. And that's where you can kind of really get a bit more detail, I think.
Fantastic. Lovely. Okay. We had an anonymous question. I think it's a really interesting question. How does your work challenge typical or dominant portrayals of Black people in history?
Well, I think they're two quite simple. The headlines are they were here and they were not enslaved. I think those are the main thing. I think a lot of people assume there were no Black people in Britain until after the Second World War. And then people tend to assume that all Africans in European history were powerless and enslaved, and it was more complicated than that.
Fantastic, thank you. Now, a question from Chester School, who ask, what was the initial response to your book Black Tudors being written by a white woman?
Well, I think there's always lots of different responses to these sorts of issues. I think, and it depends who from. I mean, in general, I got a really positive response to my work altogether. You know, a lot of nice book reviews and people interested in it. And I think a lot of people were kind of overwhelmingly just interested in the topic, and they hadn't necessarily heard about it before, even though some of those earlier books had already come out by Black scholars, actually, Imtiaz Habib and Anya Kanubia. But because my book was a trade book, it was aimed at a popular audience, and I also tried to work with schools as well to really kind of bring it into the classroom in an accessible way. I think the story got out there widely, but I would also say that obviously I think, you know, as a white woman and as a sort of Oxford educated, privately educated woman, I had opportunities to get my foot in the door, to get my book out there and to spread the word in a way that somebody from a different background might not have found as straightforward. And that's why I think it's really important that I'm, you know, not the only person to be talking about this and to continue the dialogue and to bring other people into the conversation. And I hope that I've brought the topic to a wider audience and therefore, you know, a wider, more diverse group of the next generation of historians can come to it and find more and reinterpret it, because people, you know, firstly, you never really know what people are saying behind your back. But thanks to the internet, you can sometimes find negative comments in horrible places. But no, there was somebody who accused me of cross-racial ventriloquism, partly because of those opening sections to the book where I sort of try and imagine something from the perspective of the person I'm writing about. So I think that, you know, inevitably anybody coming to source material will, you know, have biases that, you know, you can't always sort of put to one side, or, you know, that you try to be, you know, I was taught that as a historian, you have to be objective, but increasingly I think that's impossible. And it's more important to declare your biases at the beginning to try and, like, so I think I'm, you know, I'm really interested. There are, you know, younger students coming through here and, you know, and I am really interested in talking about the material with others and seeing what other perspectives there are, because, you know, maybe I got it all wrong.
Fabulous. Thank you. You mentioned about, you know, the future generations of historians. And so we did have also lots of questions thinking about the future of the study of Black Tudors and the future of teaching diversity in the curriculum. So if I could ask you Anna's question. Anna asks, how are you hoping your book might be used in the future? And she says, you know, do you think it would be an important thing to be taught in schools, or do you want it to inspire other authors to write similar works about parts of history that have been overlooked and ignored?
Oh, well, all of that sounds great. Well, you know, I don't want it pulped or used in the bathroom. Like I said, I have been working to get it into schools, and I, you know, this is part of that grand plan. Thank you for tuning in, everyone. But yeah, I have a project called Teaching Black Tudors. I've been working with educational publishers and teachers, and we've created teaching resources, mostly aimed at Key Stage 3. But there are increasing, you know, evidence that it is being taught in schools, which is great, and I'm doing my best to sort of support that. And, you know, this Future Learn course that I've mentioned a couple of times, it's a 6-week free course that anybody can sign up and do. And I know that a lot of teachers have actually started doing it. And that's, I think, really helpful, because one of the barriers to Black history being taught in schools is that teachers don't feel fully equipped to do it because they weren't taught it themselves. And so that's why I'm hoping, you know, that could be a model. And Future Learn is very open to doing more courses in this area. So I think that could be a model where if you do create these short courses, there's a new one on the colonial countryside, country houses and enslavement coming up. But, you know, the Black curriculum have done a course on teaching Black history on Future Learn as well. So I think that's one way to, and of course I want people to follow, you know, that example and get more Black history into the classroom in, you know, all periods and all topics. And yeah, I definitely hope that you know, I think that this was, people think they know the Tudors, and this was a part of Tudor history that people didn't know. And I hope that that encourages people to challenge everything they're told and go back to the archives and find new stories, because they're there, you know. And it depends what questions you ask of the past, but I'm excited to see what people find next.
Definitely. And on that, and I know we've only got a couple of minutes left, Miranda, but where do you think research on Black Tudors should go next?
Well, like I said, I think there's definitely, you know, there's definitely some important work that needs to be done, taking the archival evidence that has been brought together recently by myself and particularly MTS Habib and Onye Kanubia, and trying to marry that up and the conclusions we can draw from that alongside the literary evidence and ideas about race in the literature, to try and get a more blended kind of 3D idea of what that experience, what the African experience was, and how people, you know, as much information as we can get about what that lived experience was and what ideas were circulating, because, you know, it is, you know, as some of the questions have referred to, you know, it is so important to try and understand how, you know, the racism we're still lumbered with today evolved and came to being, because if we can understand how it, where it came from, then hopefully we could, that will help us combat it now. But I think that, like I said, we'll say that there's a lot more digitization, so there's more research. It should be a lot easier to find things in parish registers and other source material by using keyword searches in a way that hasn't been possible. But there are, sometimes you do have to go back to the archives. I think someone should go back into the High Court of Admiralty records, because I think there's going to be a lot more material in there that very badly catalogued. And like I said, you know, expanding into the Stuart period as well, and making those contrasts as well. But I'm sure people will have lots of other ideas that I haven't thought of, and I look forward to seeing where it all goes next.
Fantastic. Well, I'm really sad to say that time seems to be up on our Q&A. And Miranda, we know that you have a book to carry on sort of researching and writing. So I'd just like to say, on behalf of Westminster Abbey, how grateful we are to you for giving up your time today, and for your lecture, which was absolutely fascinating, and all the insights that you've given us today, and also the opportunity that you've given to students to sort of connect with you in this way, just asking their own questions in their own voice, which I think is an amazing thing to be able to do. I certainly don't remember having that experience when I was studying A-level history myself. So thank you ever so much for your time today. And thank you to all of the students and teachers who've taken part as well for your fantastic questions that you've sent in, really thought-provoking and challenging questions. So thank you to you as well. And I think we'd both like to wish you all the very best in your studies, and we'll definitely be keeping our eyes open, you know, to see where the future research comes from you. So all the best to you all, and thank you, Miranda. And we're going to say goodbye now. So thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.